Good night and welcome to Calvary Chapel Thursday Night Bible Study. And tonight we are continuing our study on why grace. We know tonight a lot of people who listen to this will get upset because they have the wrong unction or understanding of what is grace. But tonight that will be very well clarified from a biblical perspective. There are a lot of people and teachers who are teaching what they want grace to be rather than what grace truly is. And there's a lot of people that takes advantage of the grace of God. And we will see what Paul has to say about that in the book of Romans. But tonight we are about to study one of the key subjects in the Bible, which is grace. There are many books, thousands of books that are written on the subject of grace. We are going to open up in prayer, and on our list, we have all the individuals that we are about to pray for, and there is one that is not there that we will add to that, but we want to give God thanks, and we're going to speak individually on these people, individual lives and business. So join us in prayer as we open up in prayer. There, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor for all things. For you are holy, you are just, you are merciful and true. You are the God of love, mercy, and grace, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you don't give us justice for what we have done against you and your Son, Lord, by willfully sinning and doing things that are contrary to your commandments. We come before you, Lord, as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, the true and living God, the name that is above all other name, Elohim Adonai Yehovah. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. We glorify you. We thank you that we can come in the name of none other than Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the HaMashiach. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We come humbly, Lord, just feeling so blessed to be able to come in the throne room, Lord, on our knees, Lord, just being thankful, Lord, to be found worthy in the blood of Jesus Christ. We thank you for your Spirit, Lord, that guides us and leads us and sustains us in all truth. We magnify your word, Lord, because you have magnified your word over your name. And you said there is nothing over your name, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We come, we ask you, Lord, to bless the names on this list and their prayer requests and even things we might not know, and you know, we come in agreements, Lord, in prayer for them, Lord. We bring before you James Lockhart Jr., Lord. We pray for his blessing. We pray for his healing, physical healing. And we pray for a spiritual revival in his heart with Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, Lord. We pray for his kids, Lord. We pray for his mom. We pray for his brothers and sisters. We thank you, Lord, for him, and we pray that you will just sustain him and keep him well, Lord. We bring before you, Lord, Craig Robertson, Lord, and we pray for his recovery. That's Larry Robertson, brother. We thank you, Lord. We come in agreement with Larry in the prayer for his recovery. We pray for Larry and Wanda, Lord, and we pray that you will bless them and their ministry, continually move in their lives and provide for them. We pray for Larry's high blood pressure. We pray, Lord, for his health. We ask you, Lord, to continually bless Wanda with the right work, Lord, wherewith she is still available to do your work. We bring before you, Lord, Christina Marsh. We pray for deliverance. We pray, Lord, for direction. And we pray for a new beginning in her life. We pray for her husband, Greg, and his ministry, Lord, the revival ministry. We ask you to bless him and strengthen him and encourage him through your word, Lord, to just do what you have sent him to do, Lord. We pray for protection and provision for him, Lord, and his ministry. We pray, Lord, for Kendra Jordan and the Miller's family. We pray that you will bless them and keep them and protect their kids, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Sue Davis. We pray for her health. We pray for Teresa and Gordon Skinner and the All Nations Ministry. We pray that you will bless them as they're continually finishing the work of Inez. We ask you to bless them, continually provide and open doors for them to preach and to teach the saints around the world, Lord, with the truth of your word. We pray, Lord, for Miss Eliza, and we pray for Nikki, and we pray for Mary, that you will bless them, Lord, and just open doors, Lord, that they can walk into our church, Lord, and have fellowship, Lord, with the brothers and sisters. We pray for Mary's health, Lord, and we pray for Miss Eliza and her work, and we pray for her strength, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to bless also Miss Sandy as she is recovering from the surgery and so speedily and so miraculously. We pray for protection for her, Lord. We pray for any decision she has to make, that she bring it before you, Lord, and hear your voice, Lord. We pray for John Quill, and we pray for her strength. We pray, Lord, that she will just join the fight, Lord. Join the fight of faith, Lord. Not turning to the left or to the right, but to realize, Lord, all that we do is nothing if we're not doing it for Christ. We pray, Lord, for the ranch, Lord, Chapel Creek Ranch. We pray that you'll just bless them, protect the horse, protect them, provide, Lord, just opportunities and business opportunities for them, Lord, to grow and survive, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to bless Heidi and her family. We bless her mom, Lord. Bless her grandmother, her father, her grandfather. We pray especially for the grandfather as he has messed up his legs. We pray for healing, Lord, and a speedy recovery, Lord. We pray for Heidi's sister as she's about to get married. We pray that you are in it and you will bless it, Lord, and you'll keep them straight, and she will not turn away from you for no reason at all, Lord. And we pray that the divider that Satan has put in that family will be removed, Lord. We pray, Lord, for stability, Lord, and a strong family, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Sarah. We pray for her health and recovery and healing. We pray for her son. We pray for her husband and work for him, that he will be able, Lord, to work even closer to home, Lord. We pray for Yaremi Dixon in South America. We pray for her as you strengthen her, protect her, provide for her, Lord. We ask you to continually bless her and her sister and her children in Cuba, Lord. We pray that you'll just watch over them as Yaremi be a witness and a light unto this lost and dying world. We pray, Lord, for Miss Major, Miss Ingrid Major and Mr. Major. We pray for their business. We pray for their health. We pray, Lord, for their spiritual walk. We pray that they will just cling on to you, Lord. They'll find you, Lord, and they will never leave you, Lord. We pray for their protection, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Carrie Kissin. We pray that you'll just bless her and heal her, and pray that we will get news on what's going on with her also, Lord. We pray, Lord, for Miss Wendy Weber and Eric Weber. We pray for Miss Wendy's health, Lord, and her back and her knees. We pray for a healing, Lord. We pray for just an overwhelming blessing on their business and protection from the enemy, Lord. We pray for Mark and his health. And we pray, Lord, that you'll just continually find ways, Lord, to get Mark to be a busybody for you, Lord, and not for the things of this world. We pray for him. We pray for his health, Lord. We pray for his provision for whom and for his animals. We pray that you'll keep him safe. We pray for Waterfall as she has experienced, Lord, a true miracle after being dead twice, Lord, coming back to life and praising you and sharing it. We pray that that fire will never burn, Lord. And we pray for her mom, Anastasia Johnson. We pray for her health. And we pray for their provision spiritually, physically, and financially. We pray for Dylan and his mom, Miss McKinney. We pray for her. We pray for their family. We pray that you'll just continue to bless her, Lord, being a woman of God, Lord. We pray for Mika Emin and his recovery from cancer, Lord, as he goes through chemotherapy, that this would bring him into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, Lord. We pray for Robbie Hall, and we pray that you will just continue, Lord, to search out Robbie and just, you know, just not giving up on him and always being there for him, Lord. We ask you, Lord, that you'll help Robbie and his spiritual growth, Lord. We pray for his father. We pray for his health. We pray for his ministry as he's always preaching and teaching the word, Lord, always sharing your word and standing and being a witness, Lord. We pray for Miss Mandy. We pray for that woman of God, Lord, and we pray that you will bless her and give her peace, Lord. And we join in prayer and agreement with her for her husband, Lord, that he will come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, Lord. And we pray for peace on that home, Lord. We pray also for Chester Mobley, as he just had a heart attack, Lord, and a surgery. And you have done so much miraculous things that the family is realizing that you save his life, Lord. Not the doctors, not the medicine, not the surgery, but you, sir, you save him, Lord. And it's a light unto that family. And we pray for his daughter, Ashley Richardson. We pray that you will just bless her and strengthen her, Lord. And may she see this as a sign, Lord, that she has to come to you, Lord. She has to just desire and sell out to you. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen and amen. We give God thanks and we give God all the glory. Now we are going to, the ladies are about to go sing and worship and open us up with a song that is right for the season.
Praise God. We just give God praise tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Praise him for his provisions. Amen. Because he provides for us, even though we don't deserve his provision. Amen. And that's what grace is all about. The unmerited favor of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Just bless the Lord as we minister this song tonight.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
Father God, we just thank you for that amazing grace.
Thank you, Lord God.
Thank you, God.
Oh, we praise you, Lord. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my
like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine.
God, you
will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is he forever yours today? Amen. Is he forever yours today? Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God.
Amen. 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 Forever mine. I don't know about y'all. I only could speak for myself. In salvation, you only could speak for yourself. You can't speak for nobody else. No one else can drag you into heaven with them. And if they believe that, they're deceived. You know, they don't know the truth of the word of God. And we know that last week's study, we went through how what is not grace. And we realized what grace wasn't. We saw the Calvinism view. We saw where their graces are totally different graces called hyper-grace. And we saw how hyper-grace seems to give people a license to sin. And we know that it's not right in the Word of God. Miss Laurie, we thank you for joining us. Miss Laurie always let us know she's joining us from the Bahamas and many others. We got Stefan Bones, a little bit of dirt. We have a lot of our Bahamian people, especially in Poole, that is watching our service, so praise the Lord for that. We give God thanks for that. Tonight, we are about to really get into the study. We're about to dig into what is grace. And grace is a very, very, very crucial subject to our faith, because you cannot get to salvation apart from grace. Grace is the foundation in which the whole Christian walk is based upon. Tonight's study, we call it Lesson 2 because we had Lesson 1 already, okay? Introduction to our study today. Grace is not meant to cover up sin. Grace is the power, this dunamis power, the power to live the life that God has called us to live, as we will go through each one of these main topics tonight. Those who walk in true grace would never say that we, as Christians, are predisposed to sin. True grace enables us to do the impossibles. False grace confesses that we cannot do the impossible. But because of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we now have something they did not have in the old covenant, or what we call the Old Testament. We have the power to obey. We can do this. We have power to fulfill Yahweh's commandment. There is no excuse, according to the word of God, why we cannot fulfill Yahweh's commandment. In other words, grace is the unmerited favor of Yahweh, God, that comes with, guess what? Power. Right, Miss Sandy? It comes with power from the Holy Spirit for us to, guess what? Fulfill Jesus' commandment. And we will go into these commandments that Jesus had given. It isn't much, you know, but he has given us it. So the grace of God is the unmerited favor of God, but it just don't come alone. It comes with power. Power. You understand? You can have a dynamite with a wick, And if there is no gunpowder in it or no clay substance that creates dynamite, you just have a wick and it will burn out with no boom. So grace to most people is like the wick, but they got no boom. They got no Holy Spirit because they reject the power of the Holy Spirit to help them to overcome sin. Grace is the power to overcome sin. It's not just the unmerited favor of God. It's also the unmerited favor of God that comes with power for us to do what God tells us to do. If you go to school and the teacher says you must write out a sentence on a piece of paper, and they give you the piece of paper but they give you no pen or pencil, how can you write it out? So how can God expect us to live the life he calls us to live without giving us the power to do it? And Jesus told his disciple, and I will send the comforter, the comforter, which is the Paracletus. He will send the Paracletus. That means someone to help us. And if he sends someone to help us, guess what? You know what that means? That he knows that we need help. And if we need help, he knows it. And therefore, we must acknowledge that he has given us everything we need. There's no excuse. I hear people all the time, oh, I got to go to church so I can get this prayed over because I can't overcome this. Listen, you overcome it with the Holy Spirit. That's what grace brings, the power of the Holy Spirit. Fulfill Jesus' commandment, which is to be what? Born again. We have to die to that old master, which is Satan, the world, and the flesh. Everyone loved to fight Satan. Satan, I rebuke you, but I don't hear them rebuking their flesh. No one rebuked their flesh, right? No one rebuked the world, but they're always rebuking Satan. Satan ain't have no time for you. He has planted seeds, and that seed is growing in the life that we are living in opposition to God. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, it says, in whom the God of this world had blinded the eyes of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So it's quite clear when you wonder why, oh, my friends and my family is not coming to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, it's because the God of this world has blinded them. And we must pray that the blinders are moved. Sometimes we can't get through to people with the gospel because the blinders are on. There is a lot of religion, and each religion and cult have their own glasses. The Jehovah's Witness have some what we call the Taz T. Russell glasses. So when they look at the world and scripture, they see everything that Taz T. Russell and the Watchtower organization tells them to believe. You can say that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No man come to the Father except through me. And they look with their glasses on and they see salvation is from taking in knowledge. Yeah, huh? You reading the same thing I reading? They say, oh, it's about principle, you know, but they can't see it because the God of this world is blinding them to see. Mormonism teach that as God is, man can become. So you can become your own God. Did you hear that before somewhere in the Garden of Eden? You remember what the serpent said, right? Because God knows that if you eat the fruit of this tree, you shall be like him. That's the first lie, and that's what Mormonism believe. And they say, as God is, man can become. And as man is, God once was. God was once a man, and then he got a celestial planet. Well, I can't see that planet, but I'm just saying that people look with presuppositional views when it comes to studying the Word of God. And the God of this world have them blinded. And we must pray that the blinders are moved. Romans chapter 6 verses 15 and 18 says, that then shall we sin? This is a question. This is a rhetorical question by Paul. What then? Shall we sin? Because we are not under the law, but under grace? He says, God forbid. So Paul is saying, listen, there are people who are saying, well, if grace covers up sin, I need to sin more so I can have more sin covered up. You know, you understand? And they were thinking the more they sin, the better it is for them. But that's not what Paul is saying. They were saying, since we're not under the law, well, we could sin all we want because we got grace to cover it up. Paul said, God forbid. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to? The word their servants is the word slave. Okay? The King James put the word servants there, but it's actually the word is slave. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves slaves to obey, his slave ye are to whom ye obey. Whether of sin, meaning to sin, and you know who controls that, Satan, unto debt, that's the result, and the payment of sin is debt, separation for God for all eternity. If you're not in heaven and paradise, the only other place is the lake of fire. Or of obedience unto righteousness. If you're living righteous, you're in the kingdom of God. Verse 17 says, as we read, but Yahweh be thanked that ye were slave of sin. We were, past tense, if you know the English language. But ye have obeyed from where? The heart. See, a lot of people ain't get the heart thing yet. And they wonder why they keep going back to these mean and wicked thought. They're unforgivable. They can't forgive. You know, they wonder why they always, they got so much hate and anger, because the heart has never been touched by Jesus Christ. They never had a heart transplant. And that's what the Bible wants us to have. That's why it says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. It says, obeyed from the heart that formed of doctrine which was delivered unto you. You already had this delivered unto you. There is no excuse. Being then made free from sin, ye become slaves to righteousness. Who is the Prince of righteousness? Jesus Christ. We are now slave to Jesus, and that's how we overcome sin. Our flesh, the world, and Satan will give us all excuse why we sin. And it's okay, because the grace will cover up the sin. The more we sin, the more grace we have. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Like, it's clear in Scripture. James chapter 4, verses 4 said, ye adulterers and adulteresses, don't forget the women, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with Yahweh, with God. Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is at enmity with God. Let me tell you, I've seen all these actresses and all these stuff say they are Christians and singers and music, and they're singing worldly stuff. They're doing worldly things because they want to be friends with the world. You cannot do those things and say you are born again Christian. You have to count the cost that when you become a Christian, you can't act in those movies no more. You can't sing those songs no more. You can't go to these, Puff Daddy party and stuff. But he always changed his name. When he go in prison, he'll get another name too. But you can see what is going on. People keep on giving excuses why they want to hold on to the world. You can't hold on to the world and God at the same time. That's why we keep going back into sin. And when I say go back into sin, let me, don't be pharmaceutical. I'm talking about when sin becomes your master. When you are habitually living in sin. I'm not talking people slip up. There's nothing, that's just human. But when you practice this and this become a part of your life and it's keeping you from God, that is where the problem lies. Now tell me, who could be sleeping with their sweetheart and praying to God at the same time? Who could be stealing from their job every day and be praying to God? They'd be convicted, right? Should be, eh? So we don't want to be friends with the world, and we don't want to be friends with Satan. Luke chapter 9, verses 23 says, "And he said to them all, if any man will come after me," this is Jesus, "let him deny himself," deny the flesh, "and take up his cross daily," take up the attacks of the world, giving up the things of the world. "You will become an enemy in these people's eyesight. You will not get the right job. You will not get the things that you deserve because you're not a friend of the world and you have rejected Satan and the pleasures of the flesh." So he's saying that's what we have to do when? Daily. This is not a one-time thing. I said the sinner's prayer, I'm good to go. No, it's not a one-time thing. You have to take up your cross daily and follow him. A lot of us don't follow Jesus. We come to church and that's where it stops. That's right. Well, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, that's for me, God. I give you Sunday. Sunday is all yours. Well, not really all yours, but from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock when church out, I'll take it from there. You understand? This is what we do, and we don't realize it because we are caught up in the cares of this world and how we can please the flesh. Galatians 5:16 says, 16 through 21, we read, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." How do you know when you're walking in the Spirit? You will not be doing the actions of the flesh. "For the flesh lusted against the Spirit." These are enmity. They desire to do each other. You understand? Each one will take a leadership role. They're enemies to each other. "And the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would." You are convicted. When you know you're supposed to be a Christian and you're doing something wrong, you're convicted and you repent and you turn away from it. But if the Holy Spirit is not winning that battle, you know what's going to happen? You're going to continue in it. Someone asked me, "Well, how do you know when Satan is winning in your life?" I said, "Just look at how you're walking. That tells you who winning in your life. Because if you're walking in the Spirit, you can't be walking in the flesh at the same time. They're contrary. That's like putting water and oil together. It just don't mix." Verse 18, "But if ye be led of the Spirit," if, only if, you have a choice not to or to, "ye are not under the law." So all of us who cry and say we are not under the law, that only applies to them who walk in the Spirit. Everyone likes to say, "Oh, you won't get us back under the law." You put yourself under the law when you're not walking in the Spirit. "Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred." Yes, hatred is right in there. "Variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresy." Yes, y'all false teachers. Heresy is in that too. All right? All y'all who teaching false doctrine, it's called heresy. Verse 21, "envying women," when you look at other people, you know, envying, "oh, she thinks she look good. Them shoes only look good. She ain't look good in them shoes. They look better on me. You know, that husband he got, he better off with me, you know." Yeah, them little picky-haired children, my children would have looked better with him, you know. Yeah, envying. Envying is no different than murder. Murderous. Notice what it says, murderers. Now, a lot of people would jump and say, "You see, You should take away capital punishment because the Bible is against murder. No, it's not against murder. It's against the murderer. And it says the murderer shall be put to death. It is not against the actual act, because we have to kill you if you kill someone according to the law. But the one who does it is the Bible is against. And we have a lot of murderers out there. Sometimes you don't have to kill someone, you know, with physical things. Sometimes you tear people apart by lying on their name, by destroying their family, by causing them to lose their job. There are many people who commit suicide because lying lips is an abomination unto God, and there's a lot of liars. Trust me, we be in the court and we experience what true lies is. Just listen to them lawyers. They are terrible. Reviling and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the time past, that they which do such things shall not, what it says, shall not what? So you see that. These homosexual and these transformers, these guys dressing up like women, they believe they have a chance in heaven, and there's churches that are telling them they have a chance to inherit the kingdom of God. Yes, they do. They didn't lie. They have a chance to inherit the kingdom of the God of this world, but not the God of heaven. They can inherit the kingdom of Satan, and they're going down to hell, and these churches with them. It's sad to see how much churches are standing up for this abomination. If your pastor comes and tell you that the church is a church of love and we must tolerate this and accept this, your pastor gay. I'm telling you that. If they defending that garbage, they're part of it. That's all. They're only making way and justification in their own eyesight. I tell you, any pastor who support homosexuality, they gay. They closet sissies, and they soon come out. Keep the two great commandments. This is what Jesus is saying. Grace gives us the power to keep these two commandments. These two are the greatest commandment in the Old Testament and the New Testament. If you keep these two commandments, the question is, how do we keep them all? Because Jesus said, if you keep these two, you keep all 10. And I would like to see all 9 pertaining to this. But really, you will keep all the commandments. These two are given to us in the Old Testament and the New Testament. In Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 31, we read, "And one of the scribes came, and having heard them, reasoned together, and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked them," this is a smart one, this one think he's smart, he can get Jesus. He said, "Which is the first commandment of all?" And Jesus answered him, "The first of all the commandment is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord." This is called the Shema in the Jewish culture. "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart." Like I said, you need a new heart to love God with all your heart. "And with all your soul, all your consciousness, and all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely this, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these." Now, before I go into this part of it, the question is this: how can I keep all 10 of the commandments? I'll say 9 because I can leave out Sabbath, the fourth one, okay? Because we live in the Sabbath. We live in Christ Jesus, okay? But loving God with all my heart, soul, and mind, okay, how do I do that? I will not take his name in vain. That's how I prove I love him. I will have no other God before him, right? That no idolatry, right? So you see how you're keeping them? By loving. What is the third one? Oh, we in trouble here. When they figure this last one out, we get back to them. How do we keep the other part on the other side of the after the Sabbath? How do we love our neighbor? How does loving our neighbor fulfill this commandment, all the commandments? If you love your neighbor, you would not covet his wife or her husband or their things. You will not take their, you will not lie on them, you will not bear false witness, right? You will not murder them, right? You will not steal from them. You see how you fulfill keeping the commandments by love? If you love someone, you wouldn't do these things to them, right? And that is what the Bible is saying. Jesus is saying, you fulfill all the commandments by love. And not this Eros love or stoke love, but he is talking about this agape or agapeo love. Agape, some call it, that's God love. Agape is a different form of love, but close to God's love that human can do. We will complete them all if we learn to love. These verses are quoted from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9, the verses that Jesus quoted. Jesus didn't just make these up. You know, in all these different religions, you got the Quran, Muhammad made up all these stuff. You have the Book of Mormons, they made up their stuff. You have the Roman Catholic Church, they still making up stuff after 2,000 years. And then we have the Jehovah Witness and all their articles and things. They can never talk to you from the Bible, but they can tell you what their writing says. Jesus always quoted from the Old Testament because he gave them the Old Testament. It came natural to him. And in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 and 9, it says, that is known to the Jewish people as the Shema. The Hebrew word Shema means to hear. You see it, it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. These verses are engraved in the minds of a Hebrew Israelite from birth. This is the first thing that they had to know from memory. Right now, our young kids don't even know John 3:16. They don't even know Jesus wept. You understand? But they know every worldly song. If you say, what that girl named? Nikki, Beyonce. They know all their songs from birth. But they do not know any scripture. But if you go to the Jewish culture, they have to learn this verse. Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 and 9. And they remember that. And it says that the Jewish culture is one of the smartest cultures in the world because they teach their children how to remember scriptures. The church has turned away from that. Our Sunday school is nothing but an entertainment center for children. It is sad, but this is true. They're not teaching kids to remember scriptures and verse. And we know it's not hard because we had two little kids here, 1, 2, and 1, 4. And in 2 weeks, my wife had them learning 3 or 4 verses of scripture, and they were happy to learn it. It was posted over the entrance of their house, of the door, and also was placed in something called the post over this door in something that was called the mezuzah. And this is where they put the scripture, Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 9. And then they also had it, if you see a Jew, they have like a square thing on their head. It's a letter wrapping, and in there it has scripture. And it's called the Tefillin. And they put the scripture right there. You hear they say the phylactery. It's the same thing. They put these stuff with scripture to remind them of what the scripture says. Some Christians, we put crosses on to remind us or to tell the world we are Christians. But we know that's just a mockery because every person out there have a cross on and they'll cuss you out. They'll tell you about your mind, where you come from. Which are a set of small box letter boxes with letter straps containing scrolls of parchment inscripted with verses like Deuteronomy 6 verses 4 and 9 from the Torah. So you see, they wear this on their hand or their forehead during the time of prayer. They would put it on. You see, the Jewish people have this letter wrapped around their hand, or they have something, a big box on their forehead, and you wonder what's going on. They have a cannoli bump or something, but they had it there, and that has the scripture. And that's, they did that out of misinterpreting the scripture. It's not really scriptural, but that's their tradition. Mark 12, 31 says, "And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these two." Now we can see how Jesus took different scriptures and joined them together to make this one quote. He used Leviticus 19, verses 18, and he used Deuteronomy chapter 6, the Shema, verses 4 through 9. And it quotes the same exact thing. In Leviticus, you can read, "Thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt do what? Love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord." So you see, that's why we say, if it's not in the word, it shouldn't be heard. We'll stay on the right track. To bear the fruit of the Holy Spirit, this is what the power that comes with grace does. It gives us the power to bear the fruits of the Holy Spirit. You must be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I'm not talking about speaking no gibberish tongue. You could speak in tongue all you want and don't have no Holy Spirit. You could handa maranda and run around the building all you want. Ain't nothing happening unless you have the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And notice what the fruit of the Holy Spirit, it does not tell you speaking in tongues. And we're going to read it in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 through 24. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law." Notice it did not say prophesying. It didn't say speaking in tongues. But you see what it says? If you do not have love of God, if you don't have the peace of God, if you're not long-suffering, you're not patient, you're not gentle, you're just a rough, mean person, it's just my character. Well, you ain't in Christ if that's your character. If you don't have goodness, more like righteousness, if you don't have faith, you don't have meekness, you don't have temperance, you do not have the fruit of the Spirit. Listen, let's get this right. You cannot have a couple of them and miss out one or two. The fruit is singular, means that all of them comes together to make up the fruit of the Spirit. If you're missing one of them, you're missing all of them. Verse 24 says, "And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh," and what else? "With the affections and the lusts." Listen, it is hard to live a Christian life when you do not want to crucify the flesh and the lust. It is very hard. It's like playing tug of war. You know, the flesh and the world and Satan pulling you here and God trying to pull you here. So you go in like this. Oh, today I'm Satan, today I'm with God, today I'm with Satan. That's what you keep living in life and you think you're saved. You know how you stop living this life, a tug of war? You got to let go. If you let go of Satan, the world, and the flesh, you go in with God. But as long as you hold on to the world, Satan, and the flesh, you are with enmity, you are enemy of God. People don't like to hear it because they won't hear some sweet nothing, sweet lies that says as long as you got the grace of God, you could live like hell and you still go into heaven. No, you have to count the cost. There's a choice. There's something that you have to do. If you have the grace of Yahweh, you will bear the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Because now that you are a part of his kingdom, and we go to Romans, when we look at the book of Romans chapter 4, verses 17, watch what it says. For the kingdom of Yahweh is not a matter of eating and drinking. So you Seventh-day Adventists who like to judge people on eating meat, heaven have nothing to do with meat. And I'm a part of the kingdom of God now. So whether I eat meat or I don't, have nothing to do with you or my salvation. But of righteousness, peace, and joy, where? In the who? The Holy Spirit. It is quite clear that if we do not have the fruits of the Spirit, we are not in the kingdom of God. No matter how much we say, I don't eat meat, I eat vegetables. No, I go to church on the Sabbath, I hold the Sabbath. Oh, I sing and praise God, and I preach, and I heal, and I do. If you don't have love, joy, peace, righteousness, you ain't a part of God's kingdom, period. And if you struggle with those things, you need to repent and ask God to transform your life. And you're only going to be transformed by the renewing of your mind from the Word of God. A lot of us do not have a hunger to read and study the Word of God. It's foreign to us. I remember when the Left Behind series came out, I was witnessing to someone somewhere, and this Christian come up and he said, they got to read the Left Behind series. You know, I read all of those things. And I said, let me ask you this. Have you ever read through the Bible, the whole Bible? I said, no. I say, you don't find it funny. You read through this amount of book, and you read through that little bit of book, the Bible? You see, because the Bible don't interest the flesh. The Bible don't interest the flesh. The Left Behind and everyone else writing interests the flesh. But the Bible don't interest the flesh. It interests the spirit. It's spiritually discerning. Your spirit hunger and needs that. So if you don't have a hunger for the Word of God, you need to check the spirit that is in you. And you have to ask God to transform you and give you that hunger for the Word of God. To be holy as he is holy. Like it says, the grace is the unmerited favor of God that comes with power. And this power helps us to be holy as he is holy. I hear people that says, listen, I can't be holy. I'm not perfect. Listen, the Bible say, be ye perfect for I am perfect. The word there, perfect, means to be complete, meaning you lack nothing for salvation. You lack nothing for salvation. That's what the word perfect there means. You are complete in Christ. You're lacking nothing. But it says, grace, it comes with power, and this power helps us to be holy, sanctified, set apart unto God. Does grace cover our sins as if we never had sinned, and then gives us the power to keep on sinning? That's what people believe. They believe that when we receive grace, our sins are blotted out, is forgotten. Now there's no more sins that apply to us, so whatever we do that the world calls sin is not really sin because we're covered by grace. That's a lie, as we read from Paul in the book of Romans. Grace does not give us the power to keep on sinning. It gives us the power from sinning. It gives us the power to be holy as he is holy. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, and then verse 6, it says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in grace? Shall we continue in grace that grace may abound? Listen, I want more grace. Shall we continue in sin? Sorry. Listen, I can tell the people who ain't listening to this live because they keep calling me on this phone. All right? So Tala, Barry, and someone else, and Dario, I know you all ain't listening. So listen to me. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound, may multiply? Meaning that since we are saved by grace because of our sins, shouldn't I sin more that I might have more grace? That's what people really believe. Paul said, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? If you're dead to sin, meaning that you have been liberated, emancipated from the stronghold of sin, and now you become a servant, a bond servant of God, how can you go back into sin if you're dead to it? How you can go back to the power? Dead people can't go back under the control of something. Can a slave master who kill his slave servant bury him and then 3 days later bill him, dig him back up and tell him do this and do that? He done dead, right? You can't get a dead corpse to do nothing. And that's what Paul is saying. If you are dead to sin, how you can go back under the control of sin? Now you have to be born again back into sin. You have to denounce God and leave God and turn back to Satan. That's the problem. A lot of people have done that. He said, knowing this, that our old man, that's why, listen, it says the old man. It don't mean the age man. It means the old man, the old nature. The old nature, okay, is crucified with him, Christ, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we shall not be slave to sin to serve it. That's why the Bible says if any man be in Christ, he has a new nature. He's a new creation. For the old things are passed away, restore, all things become new. Leviticus, the book of Leviticus 27 says, sanctify yourselves, therefore, and be ye holy, for I am Yahweh, your God. So if God says we can be holy, that means we can be holy. If God say I could fly, trust me, I'm going to try fly. You understand? And if he say we could be holy, brothers and sisters, we have no excuse. We can be holy. And that holiness comes with the power, which comes with grace. Ephesians 1 verses 4 says, according as he had chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, you got some Calvinists listening to me now, and they say, see it right there. See it right there. God chose you before the foundation of the earth. Yes, he has chosen all who will be saved. You see, there's a difference. He chose all of us who are to be saved to be holy and without blame before him in love. He didn't say that he pick and choose which one he want, but he said which one becomes saved, they will be holy. You see, that's the difference. These Calvinists believe that God created some people to go to hell and some to go to heaven. I don't know about you, but what kind of God is that? They must be, who did Frankenstein? Must be that inventor who invented Frankenstein. But God don't do that. But he says all who become saved, he gives them the power to be holy and without blemish, without blame. You see that? And in love. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 14 and 16 says, as obedient children, not fashion yourself according to the former lust in your ignorance. Listen, I see this all the time. These people who say they're Christians, all of a sudden they want to wear earrings in the pulpit. They want tattoos. Everything they did in the world, they want to bring to God's house. The Bible says don't do it. Don't fashion yourself as you used to be. If you're a new creation, those things and desires should change you. I'm not saying dress like Mother Mary, but what I am saying is those old desires, you need to leave them alone. But as he which had called you is holy, so be holy in all manner of conversation. We are to be holy. The Bible says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but such which is holy and edifying unto the hearers. So if you want to know how to be holy in conversation, make sure everything that comes out your mouth is edifying. If it's not edifying, it's not holy. Now, some things you got to say a little hard and a little rough, because you know Jesus called them a generation of vipers, you whitewashed sepulchers, you sons of the devil. But that was still holy and edifying because he was speaking the truth. So don't stop speaking the truth thinking that if I say that, then I'm not being holy. No! Speak the truth in love. That's all that matters. To be an evangelist, listen, the grace that saves us comes with the power to empower us with boldness to evangelize. If you say you're a Christian and you don't evangelize, you're not a Christian. You're a Christmas tree. That's what you are. A Christmas tree stands up and looks beautiful and does nothing. An evangelist, a child of God, he can't keep still. Like they say, hands in his pants, he just got to go and share the gospel. Acts chapter 1, verses 8 says, "But ye shall receive power." You know, everyone like hear this word power in the Pentecostal church. Every time they hear the word power, dunamis power. I got power. I can speak in tongue and I can heal and I can shut them around and keep the Satan away. Say, Satan, leave him alone, you know. They got some power over Satan. They feel this dunamis power gives them that. But they are in error. They are in big time error. "But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And ye shall be my witnesses in both Jerusalem and in all Judea and," guess where, "Samaria and the utmost parts of the earth." So this power gives us the ability to evangelize. I don't care if you're 5 years old, if you say you accept Jesus Christ, you should have a Sunday, elementary Bible study. Yeah, play day. We ain't playing no kitchen. We play in church. That's what we playing. Teach your children how to play church. Don't let them be no holy rollers. Most of these little children, they singing these songs and they know the song by heart, all these worldly songs. What they need to hear is, yes, Jesus loves me. Because the Bible tells me so. Grace gives us the power. What kind of power? That dunamis power. I know the Pentecostals was waiting on this one. This dunamis power, fricative or literal, especially miraculous power, inherent power. Power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature. We can have that nature, we can have that power because our nature has changed. We now have a vessel that can hold the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, "Present your body a living sacrifice unto God." Jesus said, "Me and my Father will come inside and make our bond with you." He said, "I will send the Paracletus and he'll come alongside of you and then he will come inside of you and empower you." So our new body, our new nature can handle this Holy Spirit. So there's no excuse why we can't live holy, why we cannot evangelize, and why we cannot turn our backs on sin. This grace gives us this power. Mark chapter 16, verses 18. Now, some people believe that this here was put in by the copyists by mistakes, or they were trying to add to the scripture, but I think it was there because God wanted there. Mark chapter 16, verses 18 says, "They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." Now we know every last one of them was in scripture. We know that Paul was bitten on that island, Malleus, on his hand. And the people of that place, the villagers, they was watching to see how long he was going to drop down dead. They were counting. He get bite on his hand, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, he dead. They see Paul doing like nothing ever happened. And they watched him and they watched, they say, he got to know the real and true living God. And by that, God used that to bring that whole village to Christ. But it did not tell us to go and pick up serpent. Now, them salt rollers up here in Georgia and other places who up here picking up serpent and ting and dancing with the serpent, they don't like show you how much of them get killed from picking up the serpent. As soon as they get bite from the serpent, they say, well, he didn't have enough faith. Brother so-and-so, we love you, but you're gone. You know how much pastors get bite in their face, but they're picking up serpent? That's not what the Bible says. You don't test God in these areas. But Paul did get bite from a serpent. We can get bite doing ministry, but God can heal us. We shouldn't have no fear. It says, and if they drink deadly things, it shall not hurt them. Believe you me, I've been many places, and I believe many people try to kill me. But I drink that up like Kool-Aid. I didn't care. If I die, I go to be with the Lord. Praise the Lord. You understand? I'm not afraid of what you can give me. What I can be afraid of, and I can stop myself from going to glory? I like the 300s. Glory. We'll go to glory, you know? But it says, they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. The Bible says if someone is in the church is sick, call for the elders, and the faith of the elders shall anoint them with their head with oil, and they shall recover. The Bible tells us what to do. I don't know if you all see these practices today, but that's what the Bible says do. Every time I hear people, let's come, could you pray for us? Come pray for us. But they never say, call for the elders of the church and let them come and pray and anoint with oil. You notice that don't happen? Everyone would say, oh, in the name of Jesus, you're healing by the blood, by the blood, by the blood. You get blood all day. You bleed to death before you get healed. Listen, you got to get the scripture right. It says, call for the elders, and the prayer of the righteous shall heal the sick. You anoint them with oil. That's the instructions. And that's what we can follow. We ain't following what people do on TBN. And we still trying to get Benny Hinn White Jacket to see if it's worth. You know, I believe that going for the most money when they have an auction when he died. But in Acts chapter 1 verses 8 it says, but ye shall receive dunamis power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem. And if you don't understand this, Jerusalem was where they were. Judea was the next part. Samaria was the next part. And then the other part was all the rest of the earth. So you cannot be a witness in Ethiopia, in Canada, in Europe, if you're not a witness where you're living. Why God will send you there and you are not faithful here? You've got to be faithful. And you know what? If you're faithful, he will send you where he wants you to go. That's what it says. Now, we close up with that so you understand, to close this out, is grace does not come by itself. It comes with this dunamis power to help us to live a holy life, to overcome the world, Satan, and our fleshly nature. It helps us to walk in the spirit that we do not fulfill the lust of the flesh. It helps us to keep the two greatest commandments. Love thy God with all thy heart, soul, and mind. And second, love your neighbor as yourself. It helps us to do this one important thing, to live a holy life. It says, be ye holy, for I am holy. So if we want to cling on to this grace, we must cling on to everything that comes with this grace, that dunamis power to help us overcome the world, Satan, and our flesh. If you do not have a hunger and a passion for the word of God, I know a lot of y'all say, well, I ain't got a passion. You got a passion for soap operas. You got a passion for these new reality TV show. You can't wait to go. If you got one of them TV what could record it, you record it. You got passion for what you want. The question is, why don't you have a passion for the word of God? You need to repent and ask God to give you the Holy Spirit and let him give you that hunger, because he said we are to desire the word of God like a newborn baby desires milk. If you find a newborn baby that doesn't desire the mother's breast, that baby retarded. Something wrong with that baby. All right? You don't tell a baby to suck the breast. He know what to do. You say, you just put me there and I'll do the rest. And that's how it should be with us when it comes to the Word of God. When we have the Spirit of God, there's a passion and there's a hunger just to study God's Word. Now we reach the part of question and answer. So anyone has any question, feel free to ask. Don't let us hold you back. All right. No one has questions. None one on the internet. I guess they understood or they are still meditating on what was said today. But we'll close out today, and next week we will finish up our topic of grace. Actually, we can stop there because we don't need to go into the Old Testament example because we already gave some examples and the majority was the New Testament examples. And we know what hinders the power of grace in our life, and that is when we are walking in the flesh and not in the Spirit. So next week, hopefully, they will get to me early to give me what our next topic will be. I know this was Sandy's topic. Miss Sandy, this was your topic you asked. You wanted more on grace, right? All right. So if you don't give me a topic, I will choose the topic. All right? So you got to tell Lamar to give me a topic. I study early. So let's close it in prayer. There, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We praise you. We glorify you, Lord. For your word is powerful, Lord. Your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord. Your word cuts and it heals, Lord. We ask you, Lord, that the teaching here tonight, Lord, will go out in the hearts of men, Lord, those who are saved, those who think they are saved, and those who are not saved, to realize that the grace of God is the power to transform our hearts, our mind, and our soul to the image of Christ, and to have the desires and the passion of Christ, and to know God's word with a like nobody business, Lord. We ask you to bless us, Lord. Bless the hearers, Lord. We know that your word will not return unto you void, but it will accomplish what it was sent to do. And we ask you to bless us as we return home. And we bless those who are listening, Lord. We pray that you will just move the blindness that Satan has over their eyes, those who are not saved, that they might just repent, Lord. Just yield to God, and changing grace, in Jesus' precious and holy name, amen and amen.